Hello students, this is Dr. Ranjini, Assistant Professor in Biotechnology. Welcome to e-learning sessions in Medical Biotechnology. Today in this session, we learn how this nucleic acid analysis or the probes will be used in diagnosis of infectious diseases. These probes are advantageous over the conventional methods of diagnosis. Although diagnosis of infectious diseases starts with observations of symptoms and organs involved, it is essential to confirm or identify the infectious agent. The classical methods of diagnosis includes microscopic examination of the specimen and the cultural methods and testing of susceptibility to potential therapeutic agents, biochemical tests which involves the identification of the pathogen or the related the molecule in the infected individual, immunological methods to ascertain the identity of the isolate, and the detection of the corresponding antibodies in the infected individuals. These procedures, though routinely used for several years, the classical methods of diagnosis are slow, time consuming, laborious and less reliable. Delay in diagnosis or errors in the diagnosis can lead to delay in treatment or wrong or unnecessary or potentially toxic treatment. Culture based diagnosis is unsuitable for slow growing and fastidious pathogens. Several commercially available rapid culture detection systems now exist for Neisseria gonorrhea, for example GonoCheck, or BACTEC for certain mycobacterial species. Also, monoclonal antibodies help for early detection of viral antigens expressed on the surface of infected cells in the infected individual, but still alternative simpler procedures are required. With the advances in biotechnology, it became possible to develop newer approaches. Newer tools and newer methods for diagnosis of infections and genetic diseases help in giving the right time treatment with the more effective treatment. That's why DNA probes are advantageous over conventional methods of diagnosis. These DNA probes are tools for detection of complementary DNA molecules from the pathogens, and the application of these involve the use of some hybridization techniques. So these probes are nothing but the short strand of DNA. They are having the complementary DNA molecule in the infected individual specific to the pathogen, and these probes will be used in certain hybridization technique like dot plot technique. Here the pathogen or the infected individual DNA will be the impregnated, or it will be bound to the surface of the inert material in the form of dots. So to these dots we are going to hybridize the probes, which are labeled either with radio labeling or by fluorescent dyes. And then southern blotting, here also the DNA or the sample which is isolated from the infected individual will be separated and it will be transferred to the inert membrane, and to that we hybridize the probes. In situ hybridization, here within the cell it will be localized to identify the presence of the pathogen. Next is RFLP, restriction fragment length polymorphism. In this hybridization technique, the DNA will be taken, isolated, and it will be digested with the restriction enzyme. We know the sites of the restriction enzyme vary from one individual to another individual. That is the main reason why we carry out the RFLP. And by this, and after doing the hybridization with the labeled probe, it is easy to identify the pathogens. And in all these conditions, we are isolating the DNA, or the source of the sample will be taken. From that, we are isolating the DNA. For this, what they do is clinical samples will be collected and the cells will be lysed, and after that the cells will be, after lysing the cell, the DNA samples will be denatured and it will be transferred, or it is blotted to the membrane, inert membrane, either in the form of dots, or it will be transferred as such from the gel to the membrane in case of the Sheldon blot, and then it will be fixed by UV cross-linking, and then it will be hybridized with the labeled probes, and the signal developed by the hybridized probe will tell you the presence of the pathogen. Absence of the signal will tell you the absence of the infection. So in all these hybridization technique, we are isolating the DNA and we are transferring them to the membrane, inert membrane. Later these will be detected by labeled probe. Nowadays sensitive probes are available for Mycobacterium tuberculosis, then Mycobacterium leprae, and for the diagnosis of trypanosoma, which causes sleeping sickness, and Leishmania could also be detected, which causes Kala Azar. Now we'll see how these probes in combination with PCR will be used for the detection of the infectious diseases. So in this session, we learn how the Mycobacterium tuberculosis, or the presence of the infection of Mycobacterium tuberculosis, will be detected using the probe as well as by in combination with the PCR. Dot plot hybridization test has been developed to detect the Mycobacterium tuberculosis earlier in the clinical sample. It is highly specific and sensitive, and it can detect as low as 10 to the power of 4 cells or 10 to the power of 4 organism. But the sensitivity can be increased with the combination with the PCR, polymerase chain reaction. This polymerase chain reaction sensitivity can be improved as low as 9 bacilli. As low as 9 bacilli. 9 bacilli could be identified in the clinical samples. Non-radioactive labeling is under development, and that will enable the use of the technique even in the laboratories which do not have the sophisticated facilities. That means the in considering the safety, we are concentrating mainly on the non-radioactive labeling, so that will give the result even in the laboratory which are not having the good sophisticated facilities. As conventional diagnosis of tuberculosis is tedious, time consuming, laborious, and requires culturing, and zero diagnosis of the pathogen is unreliable, the DNA probe technology should fulfill the need. Several variations of the basic approach of combination of PCR with oligonucleotide probe are reported, which usually use very specific sequences or the target sequences. Where do we raise the primers for these specific sequences? In the Mycobacterium tuberculosis, we are concentrating on the 65 KDA antigen encoding gene. So this is the gene to which the primers are raised, and then in addition to that, the multi-copy insertional sequences, IS sequences, such as IS-986, which is very specific for Mycobacterium tuberculosis, specific to this, primers will be raised, or insertional sequences 6110. And in addition to these, we also use recombinant or the other sequences like ribosomal RNA encoding sequences are used. So when we raise the primers specific to these sequences, it is easy to identify the pathogen in the clinical sample. As I told earlier, IS-986 sequence is specific for Mycobacterium tuberculosis. Primers will be designed to amplify species and genus-specific sequences of 65 KDA gene, or else the rRNA sequences. Also, this also enable the identification of the pathogen. This approach has provided the basis for the multiplex PCR for detection and identification of various species of Mycobacterium in a single reaction tube. You take a sample and you add the primers specific to these sequences and carry out the single reaction. And in this single reaction, you can detect many species of Mycobacterium tuberculosis in a single reaction. That's why it is called as multiplex PCR. Here in this, this is the gel diagram of the PCR, multiplex PCR, where we have the many samples, clinical samples, and we have added the primers specific to the 1030 base pair, 850 base pair, and 372 and 180 base pair. And the presence of this 1030 base pair sequence is common in all the clinical sample. So this is common, that indicates that this is the Mycobacterium, the microorganism. And the respective species specific, the amplification or the amplicon will tell you the specific type of the species of the Mycobacterium. For example, Mycobacterium tuberculosis along with the 1030 base pair the amplicon, this also show the presence of 372 base pair amplicon. This is very specific when we use the insertional sequence specific primers, and this will tell you the clinical sample as the Mycobacterium tuberculosis infection. For example, Mycobacterium avium will amplify the amplicon of 1030 base pair, and in addition to that it will amplify 180 base pair amplicon. So that is specific for Mycobacterium avium. So this is absent, the 180 base pair DNA or the amplicon is absent in the PCR product of the Mycobacterium tuberculosis. So this species specific identification is possible because of the primer specific to the specific insertional sequences. And then the third one is Mycobacterium intracellulare, where you have 1030 base pair corresponding to the Mycobacterium, and you have the 850 base pair amplicon which is specific to intracellular. So that is how we can detect the different species of the Mycobacterium in a single reaction with the primers specific to the different insertional sequences or ribosomal RNA. So this will help in detecting the infection in many samples at a time in a single reaction. So that is in PCR. So this is called as multiplex PCR. So this is how we detect the infectious diseases in PCR, that help us to rapid identification of the pathogen, and you can also give the treatment in time to cure the infection. I hope in this session we concentrated on the how the probes are advantageous over conventional method of diagnosis, and how we design the probes and how these probes are labeled, and in addition to that how the sensitivity of the DNA probes or the nucleic acid analysis could be increased in combination with the PCR. So the PCR is polymerase chain reaction, where it helps us to detect the pathogen in a rapid way, in a very short duration, and we can give the treatment in time. And we also studied on the identification of the Mycobacterium tuberculosis or other species of Mycobacteria using the primers in PCR. I hope you understood this session. Thank you.